From the arm, we're going to move into the forearm. Remember, the bone in the arm was the humerus, and we talked about the different features, the trochlea, the capitulum, the medial and lateral epicondyles. Then we move into the forearm. The forearm, there are two bones, the radius and the ulna. And again, it's important to know on which side of the forearm. Remember, we always do everything from anatomical position. So, described in anatomical position, the radius is the lateral bone of the forearm. The ulna is the medial bone of the forearm. Both of them have articulations with the humerus in the elbow joint. They also have articulations with each other in what is called the proximal and distal radial ulnar joint and the intermediate radial ulnar joint. But we will not talk about those joints in this class. So let's go from the arm into the forearm, and let's first talk about the ulna. Now, how do you remember which bone is medial and lateral? Well, there are some tricks you can use to help you remember. If I stray from anatomical position and I raise my arm laterally, if I look at my forearm, I know now that there are two bones, a radius and an ulna. And I can hold this up, and we know a radius and an ulna. When we do pronation supination, the radius is the bone that is revolving. The ulna is the bone that is underneath. So simply remember ulna underneath, bring it back to anatomical position, ulna is more medial than the radius. If we look at the ulna, we mentioned when we did the arm and the elbow, has a large lump on the end called the olecranon process. The olecranon process forms that lump on the back of your elbow. Then there is, if we look at it from a medial view, kind of a C-shaped depression. That is called the trochlear notch. That will fit on the trochlea of the humerus. As you can see in this articulated skeleton, the trochlear notch fits over the trochlea of the humerus to make the hinge joint of the elbow. Immediately in front of the trochlear notch, we have a coronoid process. Do not confuse this with the coracoid process of the scapula. This is the coronoid process of the ulna. And then if we come down off of that coronoid process of the ulna, about an inch, there's a small raised area here known as the ulnar tuberosity. The ulnar tuberosity. The remainder of the shaft of the ulna is fairly round, fairly uneventful. However, there is a raised border that is a fairly sharp edge. That border is known as the interosseous ridge. If you keep in mind, inter means between, and osseous refers to bone, that ridge must be between the bones of the forearm. So if we look at this articulated skeleton again, we can see the interosseous ridge here pointing toward the radius. So the ridge will be between the two bones, the interosseous ridge. Then when we get down to the distal end of the ulna, we have a small area, small rounded area, known as the head of the ulna. And off of the head of the ulna, there is a small finger-like projection known as the styloid process of the ulna. The styloid process of the ulna. Now, there are other features on the ulna that help you determine whether it is left and right. The ulna articulates with the other bone of the forearm, the radius. So here we have the radius. The radius has a rounded head near the elbow end, the proximal end. That rounded head fits into a rounded notch on the ulna. The notch on the ulna for the radius is known as the radial notch. the radial notch. So if I want to tell if this ulna is a left or a right ulna, what I need to do is first decide which is the front, which is the back. Keep in mind, this trochlear notch allows the ulna to articulate with the humerus in a hinge-like fashion, and your elbow bends forward. It does not bend backward. So we're going to have the hinge coming forward. Keep in mind, the olecranon process is the lump on the back of your forearm. So now we know this is the front of the ulna. The lump has to be the back of the ulna, and the lump is at the elbow. So we have a choice. This ulna could be here, or it could be here. But now we know that it must articulate with the radius, the other bone of the forearm. There are two clues as to which way we are going to face this bone. One is the interosseous ridge. The interosseous ridge, remember, between bone ridge, must be between the two bones. So if I were to put the front of the ulna here and hold it this way, my interosseous ridge is right here. That would not be between the two bones. If I hold it here, so I have the front pointing anteriorly and I have the interosseous ridge here, now that would be between the two bones. Also, if we come to the proximal end of the interosseous ridge, that is where we see the ulnar notch, or excuse me, the radial notch. The radial notch articulates with the radius. So again, if I were to try and put that in my right forearm, the radius would not be here, because the radius is along the lateral side of the forearm. If I put it in my left forearm with my radial notch here, that would point toward the radius. So that should be enough information for you to determine how to tell a left ulna from a right ulna. Let's recap quickly the features of this ulna. The large lump on the posterior proximal shaft of the ulna, the olecranon process. Immediately in front of that, there is a fossa known as the trochlear notch. The front of that trochlear notch is a raised area known as the coronoid or process. If we come down from the coronoid process, we see the ulnar tuberosity. Immediately lateral to the coronoid process, we see the radial notch. Remember, the radial notch is on the ulna. Then we go down along the shaft as the interosseous ridge of the ulna. At the distal end of the ulna, we have a rounded head with a little finger-like projection that sticks up, known as the styloid process. If we look at the radius, again, it helps us to determine a left or a right radius by comparing it to the ulna. We already talked about the head of the radius. The radius has a nice round head that articulates with the ulna and the capitulum of the humerus at the elbow joint. We have a head, and right below the head we have an area known as the neck. Then there is a tubercle on the radius known as the radial tuberosity. Then again, as we go down the shaft is fairly rounded, but there is a sharp border on that shaft. That sharp border is known as the interosseous ridge of the radius. That's a big hint. That ridge needs to point toward the other bone. At the distal end of the humor or of the radius, it kind of fans out a little bit like a spoon, and it has a notch, an ulnar notch. The ulnar notch is on the radius because it's a notch for the ulna, just as the radial notch was on the ulna. And although it is not as pronounced, there is a projection on the distal end of the radius known as the styloid process of the radius. So we have almost all the information we need now to determine whether this is a left or a right radius. We know the head goes toward the elbow end, so it could be here or here, or here, 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 and here. Well, what have I done? I flipped it anterior versus posterior and medial versus lateral. Remember, the radius is the lateral bone of the forearm, so it either must be here or here versus here or here. Now all we need to determine is what is the front of this bone versus what is the back of this bone. So we need to know anterior versus posterior. The easiest way to do that is to use your imagination. And I don't want to throw anybody off on this, but use your imagination. If you cup your hands, your forearm comes down and then ends as a cup in your hand, anteriorly. If I flip it over, I come down and I don't end as a cup, I end as knuckles on the back of my hand. Well, don't get confused. I'm not implying that these bones go out in the hand. I'm just giving you a way to keep straight anterior posterior. If you look at the front of the radius comes down and forms a cup-like structure on the distal end, whereas the posterior portion of the radius comes down and has some ridges on the back, much like you would have knuckles on the back of your hand. So if you just kind of use that little bit of imagination, the cup portion of this radius is the front, just like your palm forms a cup in the front. The knuckles would be the back, just like you have knuckles on the back of your hand. Now again, don't get confused. I am not implying the radius and the ulna go out to the hand. They don't. I'm just trying to show you some tricks you could use to keep it straight. So now I know the elbow end, I know the front, and I know the interosseous ridge must point toward the other bone. So let's try that. If I put this in the right forearm, I have the elbow end, I have the cup in the front, but I have the interosseous ridge pointing laterally. That can't be between the two bones. So this can't be a right radius. So let's try it on the left forearm. The head near the elbow, the cup toward the front, and now the interosseous ridge pointing toward the other bone. So this would be a left radius. Now let's put that together with the left ulna that I had so we can see how the head of the radius fits in the radial notch of the ulna, the head of the ulna fits in the ulnar notch of the radius. Now when we are flexing and extending at the elbow, that is movement only of the ulna. When we are doing pronation supination, that is movement of the radius, but not the ulna. The radius will revolve around between the heads of the radius and the head of the ulna. But in pronation supination, we do not move the ulna. We revolve the radius. Much like we see here on this articulated skeleton. Notice that during flexion extension at the elbow, we're not moving the radius. The radius is going along for the ride. During pronation supination, we are not moving the ulna. The radius is doing the movement.